Dead people are dead.
Danvers.
No, there's no heaven, there's no hell. There's no ghosts. Fucking beyond. There's nobody out there just waiting for us, watching us.
Then why do you keep that around?
There, happy? Okay, there's nothing except us. We're here, Navarro. Okay, alone. The dead are gone. Fucking gone.
Welcome to this week's episode of Screen to Screen, a real podcast. My name is Justin Cary, and thank you so much for joining me to discuss the latest episode of True Detective Night Country, the fourth episode of season four, and a really good one at that. This week, the mystery continues to unfold, although not in the ways we might have thought. Like ice splintering in strange directions, the case breaks, but not how we thought it would. And we start to peel back the skin of what's really going on with Liz and Navarro, like an orange rolling ominously from under the bed. In an episode laced with themes of disappointment, loss, unmet expectations, tragedy, and regret, we find ourselves dredging up some old memories as we explore a ghost ship of shadow, all of us lost down in the depths of the night country. So hang those stockings with care. Put in your UV teeth whiteners and grab some coffee. The investigation is on.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why do you...
All right. Season 4, episode 4. Before we get started, a couple of notes. As this episode did and as it started with, I just want to take a mention here, a kind of a and just mention this episode does get into some pretty heavy issues and some pretty serious things, self-harm and suicide being one of them. If you are struggling with any issues related to suicide, self-harm, or mental health in any kind of way, please know that there are resources out there for you. 988 Suicide and Crisis Lifelines exist for these reasons. 988lifeline.org or just calling 988 is a way to get in touch with folks that can support and help. So these resources exist. Please seek support if you are struggling with mental health issues. There are resources for you out there and you are not alone. I thought this was a really, really excellent episode. Oh, and one other technical note. Last week, there were a couple of pops on the episode. I have fixed that. Hopefully this week, it should be better. I think I've fixed that issue. So hopefully I will have spared your ears some of the popping sounds as you are listening this week. So apologies for that last week. But yeah. Okay. Season 4, episode 4. This one started off a little bit slow, but my goodness, did the pace pick up as we got into the latter part of this episode. And I think things are really kicking off now on this season, and it's really, really, really good. So many thematic things happening in this episode. I thought this episode really did a nice job of sort of layering in themes connected to the story that it was trying to tell in a really smart visual way and a really smart sort of writing way. I was really impressed by that throughout the entire episode. We start this episode again with this idea of sleeplessness. We keep coming back to this theme of like people struggling to sleep on this show. Obviously they're in, you know, this place where it's eternal night. This is the subtitle of the season, Night Country, which in this episode takes on an entirely new meaning, which we're going to get into but a little bit later. This part of the world, it is nighttime for 3 months, Night Country. Night country, though, could mean a couple of different things after watching this episode. I'm starting to think that night country might actually be a reference to some sort of dream-like state that the characters potentially could be in this show. I mentioned this sort of somnambulic, dream-like feeling that the show had in its premiere episode. I don't think I was wrong to point that out. I think there is something going on with that. I think this idea of almost like a waking nightmare is very on point for what's happening potentially here, but more on that later. So we open this episode with Liz sort of unable to sleep. She has a white noise machine on. It's 3:30 in the morning. It's sort of that's an interesting time. 3:30 just being or 3 o'clock being a weird sort of interesting time just generally. And it's this episode takes place on December the 24th. So Christmas Eve is when most of this episode happens. Liz can't sleep, so she is sort of on the case watching the Anne video over and over again on her phone. And it has some weird stuff in it that they're trying to figure out. In case you forgot, in episode 3, they found this video of Anne, the murder victim that Navarro is interested in. They've made some connections between Anne and the Salal scientists. And Liz is watching this video. And, you know, they're not quite sure what's happening in this video. There's some sort of ice cave in it. There are fossils. It's as though Anne was murdered somewhere in this video and then her body was taken somewhere else. So Liz is trying to figure this out. So she goes driving and she runs into, she doesn't want to, she's sort of watching this video and she doesn't know what to do with it. So she goes out in her squad car and she runs into Julia. Julia is Navarro's sister who is struggling with mental health. Navarro has been trying to take care of her. The struggles continue. Liz finds Julia out in the cold, just sort of walking. It's like, 30 degrees below zero out in Ennis, Alaska. Julia's out in the cold, and she's sort of removing her clothing in this dazed state. Obviously not going to last very long taking off your clothes in this weather. So Liz sort of stops her, puts a coat around her, and brings her to the police station where she meets up with Navarro. And Navarro, they don't talk much about Julia. Navarro just kind of takes her home and they briefly talk about this video, but there's a lot of tension there. And they don't really want to talk. They're upset because the case revolving around the scientists is kind of coming to an end. The bodies have thawed. They're taking them to Anchorage. Ted, the chief of police, is sort of coming back to get involved here to kind of take the case away from Liz and Navarro. They don't want this to happen. Liz doesn't want Ted to get involved because, you know, there's this power struggle there. Remember, this is the guy that she's sleeping with. He's kind of holed up at this little motel. And then we sort of see Navarro check her sister Julia into this mental health facility, Lighthouse. So Julia kind of reluctantly checks in here. In the meantime, Peter, the young cop that Liz is kind of working with, lets Liz know that he found a person of interest in the case in his research. He's a guy who's sort of got similar injuries as the Salal scientist. So this is interesting. You know, they found this person Peter lets Liz know about this. He wants to go home to his family. It's Christmas Eve. Liz says no, put out an APB on this guy. Peter's like, it's Christmas Eve. Liz keeps pushing him and pushing him and pushing him, and he keeps giving in. This is the first sort of flavor of this theme of expectation. You know, Peter wanted to be a cop, wanted to do the right thing. He had this sort of heroic expectation for the work that he was going to be doing. But it turns out it's not quite what he expected it to be. It's a lot of long hours, and it's created this huge tension and rift in his family. His family is kind of falling apart because he can't stand up to Liz, and he wants to be a good cop, but he also wants to have a family, and it seems like he can't figure out a way to have both of those things. So, you know, he's struggling with that. His expectations are not aligning with the reality of his life at this particular moment. There is this other sort of side plot in this episode with Hank, Peter's father, who is this other more senior police officer that doesn't get along well with Liz, but he has been talking with this woman that he's been having a relationship with online, Alana, and he's been chatting with her, texting with her, sending her money, and apparently she is supposed to arrive in town tonight. And throughout the episode, we see that he has made a lot of plans to meet up with her, and, you know, he's supposed to meet her at the airport. He's got a little bear. He's got this huge, you know, grin on his face to meet her on her when her plane arrives. Later, we see that he has prepared, you know, a bed for them with roses and this whole scene, and he's very excited for this Christmas rendezvous with this woman that he really likes. And then we come to find out most likely that he's been scammed out of money by a person on the internet. It's quite sad, actually. This is a character that isn't really that likable. He's not great. He's the one that hit his son. He drinks. He's not a very good cop. But we sort of feel for him in this moment that he, too, is sort of a victim of his own expectations, right? Like, he's a victim of loss. Like, he wants something. He's set himself up for this, and he's disappointed. This theme of disappointment is laced throughout this episode. A disappointing, outcome here. A disappointing, you know, family life for his son. Liz's mother-daughter relationship with Leah is disappointing. The case turning out like this is disappointing. Obviously, the fact that Navarro can't help her sister, disappointment. It's all this sort of theme of disappointment throughout this episode. Really interesting. We get this, you know, the theme of riding around in the car with the two detectives is seen throughout this series. So we get this great moment where Liz and Navarro have this discussion in their squad car about prayer and the power of prayer. And Liz tells this story about when she lost her mother at 7 years old. And Liz prayed so hard because her father told her that if she prayed that her mom might survive. So Liz prayed so hard that her knees turned black and she couldn't even walk at her mom's funeral. And apparently this was not enough to save her mom. And so this sort of, from a very early age, sort of jaded Liz, right? And again, it's this theme of expectation, right? Liz was told that this would happen if she did a certain thing. She did the thing as much as she could do it. She did it till her, you know, legs didn't work anymore. And it didn't work out that way. And so this idea, this theme of expectations not playing out the way that you think that they should be, even though you've put in the work, is seen throughout this episode. It's a really interesting conversation about this idea of prayer or faith or belief. And it starts to give us a sense of who Liz really is. Like, the things that she believes in are not playing out the way that they're supposed to. And it gives us a sense of why she kind of doesn't believe in anything at this point. So a lot of just sort of continuing the investigation, the same sort of stuff. They're just following up leads, looking for suspects, same stuff that's been happening. One of those leads is this sort of like this video that they found on the phone with Anne. What is this ice cave place? There are no ice caves around here. So they decide to go follow up this whole ice cave thing. They go back and they talk to this teacher friend of Liz's who she slept with. He's married, kind of awkward. They visit him on Christmas Eve, but he gives them a lead on, there are some ice caves around here at a place called Brooks Ridge. And when he looks up the name of the person who mapped out these ice caves originally, we come to find out that this person, Otis Heiss, is the same guy that Peter, the young cop, found out is the guy that had the similar injuries as the Salal scientists earlier. So now we have this really interesting connection of the guy who mapped out these ice caves is the same guy who they're looking for. All right, so now we can start to think, oh, okay, this guy is important. This ice cave mapper outer guy knows something. I mean, he's got the eye injuries, he's got the ear injuries, he's got similar injuries to how the Salal scientists' bodies ended up. This guy's important. So up until this point, the episode is, you know, it's going along at a sort of a normal pace, but things really start to kind of get a little interesting right around this point, because we cut to a scene with Navarro's sister, and we once again are reintroduced to our friend, the mysterious orange. Julia is in her room at Lighthouse, and she's sitting on the bed. She looks down, and from underneath the bed between her feet rolls out the orange, symbol of death, that I mentioned in the last episode. Kind of freaks her out. She looks under the bed, and there's one of these ghostly body ghost guys under her bed. We get this sort of jump scare moment. It really scares her, and she sort of, recoils up against the wall. This dead ghost body guy also has the crucifix with him that Navarro found in her truck that she threw out into the road a few episodes back as well. So we keep getting these same repeated symbols, the crucifix, the orange, these dead bodies. We're seeing these same symbols a lot. And then we cut to Rose, interestingly enough. Rose comes back in this episode. Navarro goes to visit her for some reason. We're not really sure. I'm not really sure why Navarro decides to visit Rose on Christmas Eve. But she just sort of shows up at Rose's house, and Rose is all dressed up for Christmas Eve, all dressed up and nowhere to go. She's sort of just hanging out, and she's prepared this amazing feast for herself for Christmas Eve. And Navarro just kind of shows up and is treated to this lovely formal dinner at Rose's place. And Navarro asks her some interesting questions about who she was before she was Rose Angenoux. Apparently she was not always Rose Angenoux, and she was someone else before she was here in Alaska in a relationship with Travis Cole. So who is she really? We don't really know. I don't know. I'm sure maybe some more eagle-eyed fans of True Detective might be able to put some of these pieces together. But it's just an interesting scene. I think Rose is a great character. Quick side note here. Rose is sort of an ex-academic, apparently. She's a professor who one Tuesday after coffee decided to just leave because her work felt just like noise, which I can sometimes very much relate to. So I was able to connect with her a little bit here. But I thought this was a great scene, and I love the sort of opulence of this scene. In the middle of the complete barren wasteland of Alaska, here we have Rose's just sort of complete opulent Christmas Eve dinner, where we barely have like cookies in the convenience store for everyone else. Somehow Rose has this like amazing like feast of Christmas Eve prepared in her house. So just a very interesting scene I thought was really cool. I also need to go back and take another look at episode one to see if any other characters actually interact with Rose Angenoux other than Navarro, because I'm starting to have a sneaking suspicion that we're going to get a bit of a sixth sense moment at some point here with Rose. And, Liz shows up at Rose's house only to find it just like abandoned, and that Rose Angenoux is actually one of the dead that she seems to complain about making so much noise out here in the ice of Alaska. Because I know that Navarro interacts with Rose, and Rose is just kind of standing around in that scene. So it would be interesting to go back and watch that episode now. Is Rose really there, or is this just another one of Navarro's mystery visions, which we will talk about here in a few moments.
Merry Christmas, Missy.
Is everything okay?
Yeah, I just stopped by to say Merry Christmas. Jesus, did you make all this?
Of course I did. All of Santa's elves drowned in global warming, darling. And the rest are all meth heads.
This is amazing. What were you, Rose, before?
You mean before I was old and crazy?
No, I mean before Alaska. Your name isn't Rose Angenoux, is it? You never talk about it.
Well, I was a very serious professor in a very serious school writing very serious ideas.
Why'd you leave?
One Tuesday morning after coffee, I sat down to polish some pompous, useless article, and I just had enough. I had enough. Every damned word I'd written in my entire life was meaningless. Making so much noise. So much noise. It is a little quieter here. Mostly. Except for all the fucking dead.
So from this point in the episode, things do start to kind of pace up a little bit. This Christmas Eve continues to get crazier and crazier and more tragic. We cut to the Silver Sky Mines. There's a giant protest graffiti on the front door of the mine that says murderers. It turns out that Liz's daughter, Leah, has spray painted the doors. It seems like Leah has made a final stand here. This is her moment to sort of break away from Liz at last. And Liz sort of has this moment with the mine owner, who we've seen confront before. The mine owner wants to press charges against Liz's daughter. Liz says, come on, don't do this, Amy. Like, this is the, I think that's her name, Amy. Don't ruin my daughter's life just because she's acting out. And the mine owner just kind of walks away from this. But again, this is sort of like, this is another example of like expectations, right? Like Liz doesn't like, this isn't how she thought it was going to be, right? This isn't how anyone thought any of this was going to be. It almost feels like a bad dream for a lot of people. Again, this theme of like, is this a bad dream? Like, everyone just sort of seems like they're having a bad dream. From here, we get a call. We get a scene where Julia phones Navarro on her cell phone and says she loves her. And we can kind of see that Julia is not in her room at Lighthouse, but she's out at the boat again where she was before, out in the cold. And she takes her clothes off and stacks them up in a very similar way that as the scientists did. We saw the stacks of clothing in episode one. And she just kind of walks off into the cold, dark night. She kind of just walks out. Very similar, we might presume, to what the scientists might maybe did. Sort of, you know, no clothing, off into the night, just kind of walking out. We're not led to believe that Julia died or perished in the same sort of horrific way that the scientists did, but she certainly did freeze to death. And we come to find out later that she actually walked into the ocean and drowned in the freezing water. And so Julia sort of took her own life. She just could not handle this sort of mental health crisis that she was facing any longer. And we get a little more insight into what that actually was from Navarro a little bit later. So this theme of death now is very real in this episode. We cut back to Liz's house. Just, I wrote down the number of her home is 3451, adds up to 13. Interesting number, you know, if we're talking about death. You know, if we're just talking about 13, just being an interesting number in a lot of ways. 13th tarot card is death. So this episode, the first sort of major character death, the orange symbolizing death, Liz's home, the numbers add up to 13. So, you know, 13, death, lots of things going on there. Leah leaves. Obviously, you know, this is upsetting to Liz. I think that the show does sort of make this vision, and this might just be me, but I think there is this visual comparison being made between Annie, the murder victim that Liz is investigating, and Liz's daughter. I think there is a visual resemblance there, and I think Liz is seeing that because she, as soon as Leah leaves, she just watches the sort of final moments of Anne's life on this video over and over again. She starts to drink and kind of gets drunk. She throws away the Christmas turkey, like just tosses it in the trash, kind of gives up like on the whole like
we're going to have a normal family Christmas, like, just throws that idea away. And then Liz kind of makes this connection between the video she has from the scientists from Salal and the video that she has of Annie. And she notices that at the end of both of these videos, the power sort of goes out. She thinks it's a feature of the video, but then realizes that, like, it's not that. It's some sort of power outage similarity. And then in her mind, she puts this together with Oliver Takok, the sort of Alaskan man that they went and interviewed in the last episode. She remembers that he was the equipment manager at Salal. He would have had access to generators, to power equipment. And since both of these videos have this sort of power outage moment happening, she wonders if perhaps he has something to do with this. She immediately calls Navarro, who has not yet heard about her sister's, demise, and wants to go talk to Oliver. Navarro's like, no, you're drunk, you can't. And so instead of Navarro coming to pick up Liz, Liz decides to go ask young Peter to pick Navarro up instead. Peter, of course, doesn't want to do this because he has a family of his own. He wants to be with them for Christmas Eve. But again, Liz continues to push him. And this is where we see more of this theme of, like, we get this really great sort of moment here when Leah, Liz's daughter, arrives at Peter's house, right? This is where Liz goes when she leaves. This is where Leah goes when she leaves Liz's house. She goes to Peter's house because that's where her grandmother and stuff lives. And we see sort of this great contrast of, like, different kinds of family, right? We have Liz and her attempt at family, which is just this very cold, very unsuccessful attempt at creating a family, right? Turkey thrown in the trash. Anything that's meaningful is tossed in boxes, right? Liz believes in nothing. She's super cynical. She's not a good mom. She's not really a good cop. She's not a good partner. She's sort of failed at a lot of things. All of her expectations have sort of been shattered. The police family, right, is this very demanding thing, right? Like, this is your family. You will serve it. You will do what you're told. That's sort of how Liz runs the police family. It's very much do what I tell you and never say no. And then we see the indigenous women in their family. And it's this beautiful, warm, loving moment of just, like, kneading dough in the kitchen. Like, what family kind of is supposed to feel like as Leah enters into something that feels, the way it's sort of shot, like a real family. Something that I don't think she feels at all when she's with Liz. I think it's a beautiful sort of, like, cinematography moment of, like, cutting back between Liz at home with this, like, dead bird in a pan that's uncooked, thrown in the trash, the police station, and then this moment of, like, the bread dough being kneaded in this warm kitchen light. It's just a really nice moment. So Navarro and Peter go and investigate this encampment where Oliver Takok lives. And they find that his home has been abandoned. It's, like, frozen. Everything's frozen over in his house. And it's as though he's disappeared. He's left his chair that he was sitting in before. His shotgun is there. His boots even are there. And he's left a spiral symbol with a rock on top of it that has these infamous spiral sort of carved into it. The other members of this encampment don't like the police presence. The dogs are barking at them. And Navarro and Peter get out of there. Meanwhile, Liz gets drunk and goes and visits her police chief slash lover slash, you know, sex partner, Ted. And she has plans to go have sex with him, but she just kind of goes in there. I don't think she really wanted to have sex with him. I think she wanted to just get in a fight with him. But she goes in there and he's kind of got this UV teeth whitener thing in his mouth. He's watching Elf. A few different people are watching Elf on this particular December the 24th. The Will Ferrell movie. And she goes in there and they kind of get into this little fight because he mentions Jake and Holden and how she kind of became a worse cop and a worse friend and a worse person to people after Jake and Holden. And so as soon as he starts talking about that, she kind of puts her clothes back on and leaves angrily. And he says, no, you can't drive. She doesn't care. She leaves anyway. We get a lot of scenes. There's a lot of intercutting scenes. Like, there's a lot of different things playing out across town this Christmas Eve. So a lot of different cuts here. So all at the same time, we've got Liz and Ted. We've got Hank being sad because his plans didn't play out the way he expected them to. We've got this beautiful scene where Peter arrives back home and he opens his front door and his Christmas tree is just like pulsating with this amazing light. It's almost like it's like the heart of the home, but it's like dying almost. You can almost see it like pulsing, like this last little like beating heart of light, but it's almost like fading out. And his family life is dying because he's dedicating himself too much to his work life. And he gets into bed with his wife. She's completely on the other side of the bed from him. There's this huge rift between them. And he says, like, just tell me what you think. Like, I've ruined your life, right? You wish you never married me and you wish we never had the kid. So things are really bad at home with Peter. So we get cuts of that. We get this sort of, in between all of this, Navarro gets the call about Julia and she's reeling from the loss of her sister. We get this sort of driving home scene with Liz where she's leaving Ted and she is driving half drunk and she sees the one-eyed polar bear on the road. She swerves, hits a snowbank. One-eyed polar bear gets right up to her window and then walks away. Throughout this, we hear a lot of language about being alone, alone, alone. Navarro, in a fit of rage, goes to Lighthouse, confronts the desk clerk, yells at him, "What are you doing? You let my sister go. Now she's dead. She's just filled with rage. She's so angry. She doesn't know what to do with it. She sees the guy from episode one, the guy that, you know, she kind of arrested, and she ends up just getting in a fight with him, and they beat the shit out of each other, and she ends up at Kavik's house, and he kind of tends to her wounds, and she asks him, "Why are we alone? Why are you alone? Alone. Why are we all alone?" And we come back to this conversation the next day when Navarro visits Liz. But this is a theme of this show, alone. Why are we alone? What does it mean to be alone? And what does it mean when the people we love leave us? And do they leave us alone?
Why the fuck you let her leave?
Man, you can't come in here after hours.
My sister. Julia Navarro, we checked her in earlier today, and you just let her walk out the fucking door.
If you want, here, let me check on the system.
What are you checking? She's not fucking here. Are you listening?
I'm sorry, ma'am.
You don't even know she's fucking gone. Are you kidding me? On your computer, does it say how the fuck a mentally unstable patient just fucking disappears?
Ma'am, this isn't a detention center. It's a voluntary facility.
Well, it's a shit fucking facility. You just let people fucking die! What the fuck? You're so fucking kidding me!
So we get this really emotional scene as Navarro just doesn't know where to place her anger. And that sort of ends the Christmas Eve day. It's in a big sort of flurry of emotions for so many people. That night, Liz dreams of who we come to find out is someone named Holden, which it seems to be her son who died. Navarro confronts her about this the next day when she comes to her house, and Navarro finds this stuffed animal bear. And she asks Liz, you know, if you don't believe in anything, if you don't believe that we're not alone, that if you don't believe that there's a heaven or a hell, if you don't believe in any of this stuff, then why do you keep this bear around? And Liz is like, fine, I'll throw the bear out. She throws the bear out into the snow. And then in that moment, Navarro chooses to tell Liz that her sister took her own life last night. And then the two sort of have a moment of trying to console one another there. Liz, just before Navarro tells her this, very adamantly says, "The dead are gone." And so as Navarro and Liz are having this confrontation, Navarro sort of in a moment of vulnerability sort of tells Liz that she feels like Navarro feels like she has the same affliction that her sister has, this curse, this thing that's following her around, this thing. And we get this really important, I think, moment in the show where Liz and Navarro finally sort of reveal to us, the audience, what really happened, or at least a little bit more about what really happened with this Wheeler case that Liz was talking to Peter about a few episodes back, right? This call that Navarro and Liz went on to this Wheeler house where this guy Wheeler had just murdered his girlfriend. And they arrive, and as Liz and Navarro tell the story, it was a murder-suicide. They got there, and everybody was dead, but that wasn't really what happened. They got there, and Wheeler was still alive, and we don't really know what happened next. But here, in episode 4, Liz is talking to Navarro, and she's saying to Navarro, but you saw something. You saw something in that room with Wheeler. And we, the audience, get a flashback and we sort of see what Navarro saw. And Navarro saw in that room some sort of ghost, some sort of spirit, some sort of vision in that room that pointed at Navarro and screamed at her. So this scene is really important because we're finally now starting to solidify the idea that it is Navarro who is the one who is sort of in tune with whatever spiritual, ghostly, undead force is at play here in Ennis. So it may not be like a general, there are ghosts in Ennis. It may be very localized to Navarro, and it may have to do with schizophrenia or whatever mental health issue might be afflicting Navarro, her sister, her mother. That could be what's going on here. We'll see. But there's also the Salal scientists at play. There's a few other questions involved here. But it's really interesting that it's sort of Navarro and her role in all this is sort of becoming the focus in some ways. Really important scene. Really interesting scene. All about this idea of expectations falling apart, hopes, dreams, like what is this sort of like, you know, I don't know. You know, I think it's just really interesting. Navarro is becoming a really interesting sort of piece of the puzzle. They get a call. Someone saw somebody out by something called the Dredges wearing this pink coat that Clark, the person they've been looking for, has been wearing. So Navarro and Liz head out to this thing called the Dredges, which is this big sort of ghost ship out in the ice. They get out there and they start to go in and investigate this ghost ship, and they find someone in the ghost ship. They think it's Clark. It's a really great scene. They're kind of flashlighting their way through this ghost ship, this sort of rundown, decaying mining dredging ship or whatever, and they're chasing this guy wearing the Clark's coat through the ghost ship, and they kind of get split off at one point because Navarro thinks she sees Julia. She sees something. She sees footsteps. She sees whatever. So she starts going one way. Liz starts chasing the suspect, and then we get this really creepy, cool, like Blair Witch Project moment where Liz corners the guy in some creepy little dark room, and he's kind of cowering in the corner with his head down. It's really Blair Witchy. It's really creepy and cool. We come to find out that it's not Clark. It's actually this guy, Otis Hess, the guy who mapped the caves, this person of interest they've been looking for. It's him. And Liz starts to ask him some questions about where is Clark? And he basically says to her, he's gone back down to hide in the night country. We're all in the night country now.
Otis, talk to me. Where's Raymond Clark?
He's gone. He went back down to hide.
Where is he hiding? Navarro? Navarro. Where you been? I've been looking for you everywhere. Otis, where is he hiding?
He's hiding in the night country.
And this episode ends with this really creepy, ghostly a cappella version of Twist and Shout, which I was talking about in the few episodes back as being, I think, an important sort of allegorical song for this show. A song that Liz can't stand to hear because it has something to do with her son, who we think now is Holden. From here, from this moment, we also cut into that scene. We see Liz finding Navarro, who something has happened to Navarro as well. Interesting editing there, too. We sort of get this weird intercut edited thing where I think what we're seeing there is after Liz leaves Otis or leaves him or arrests him. I'm not exactly sure that it's a weirdly cut scene. Sort of two things happening at the same time. But Liz also finds Navarro, who something has happened to Navarro. Her ear is bleeding. She's had some sort of traumatic thing happen to her, similar to the Salal scientists. She's sort of sitting in front of this weird Christmas tree that's in this derelict ship. She's had an encounter with some sort of ghost or a spirit or something that's sort of screamed in her face. And she's sort of bleeding out of her ear with this sort of almost catatonic stare and sort of sitting cross-legged on the floor. So what is the night country is the big question here, right? I think it's taken on a new meaning now that we've heard Otis speaking about it this way. We're all in the night country now. Is the night country some sort of somnambulic state that has sort of descended upon the town of Ennis? Is it some sort of poison that has seeped into the water from the mine? Is it some sort of, I don't know, like it feels almost like this line, we're all in the night country now, and this idea of Clark descending or hiding in the night country, it sounds like almost somewhere, some place, right? Almost like the Upside Down from Stranger Things, similar idea to that, like a place you can go to that is different from this place that we're in now, almost like some sort of undead realm. That sounds a little bit like, that's probably a bridge too far for a show like True Detective. Like, I don't think we're going to go to a place like that because we're not in like a show like Stranger Things. I think some sort of portal to some other dimension, I think, would be too much. And I think that would really take this show to places that it shouldn't go to. But this idea of maybe like, I don't know, like, what is the night country? Like, what is night country? Is a really interesting concept and thought. So I'm excited to see what that means, where it goes. What does it have to do with dreams and sleep and twisting and shouting and these ghostly visages that everyone is seeing, or maybe just Navarro is seeing? And where are we headed next? I think there's only 6 episodes of this show, so we only have 2 left. And if that's the case, there's a lot of stuff that needs to happen in those 2 episodes. And I think the next one has got an early premiere on next Friday evening. So we'll see. But so far, so good. I thought this one was excellent. The themes were all there. There was a lot of, the pacing was really cool. Just a lot of stuff happening in this one, probably more than we really have time to get into here. But I hope you enjoyed this recap. I'd love to hear your thoughts. Feel free to send me a message if you want to find me on Instagram, Justin R. Cary, Facebook. Send me a message to the podcast. all sorts of different ways to find me. But what are you thinking about Strangely, what are you thinking about Night Country True Detective season 4? Are you digging it? I like this season a lot. I think it's really cool. The performances are great. I thought the performances in this episode especially were really good. Callie Reese was excellent in this episode. I thought she was just, she brought that anger in that scene after Julia died in the hospital. Like, that just felt so visceral and so real. I just thought that was great. And I think that I'm impressed that Jodie Foster's star status is not like overshadowing the rest of the cast of this show. I think she's brilliant, but she's kind of doing a really good job of being that character. And I think the rest of the cast on the show is really sort of shining in their own way. So yeah, let me know what you thought. What is Night Country? Who is the one eye? Are we going to see more oranges? What are your thoughts? Thank you so much for listening this week. Let me know if you have any thoughts or questions. What would you like to hear as we go forward? And yeah, is there anything that I'm missing? What did you pick up on this week as you watched True Detective episode 4? And as always, thank you so much for tuning in to Screen to Screen. My name is Justin Cary. And as always, the investigation is on.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me?